Mark is supportive of our groups all through the year, and this is just another example. He's wrote a check for $500 for the Republican Men's Club. It doesn't get any better than that.
But without further ado, our Congressman Mark Amodei.
Thanks, Mr. President. Listen, Ira basically took all my time, so what are your questions? For those of you wanting to get your picture taken with Ira, we're going to have a chance for you to do that. Mine are free. His cost about $100 a piece. Thank you. Actually, I appreciate it, Ira. I'm going to have some nightmares tonight thinking from when I was back there, but well put and accurate. How many of you have heard the Minute with Mark things on the radio over the last year? We just did one, because we're going to start up in a couple weeks again. And we did one about editorial boards and letters to the editor on public lands bills saying, you know, it's obvious that they either didn't read the bill or read the bill and chose to ignore the plain language in it. And so Ira's presentation reminds me of the challenge always in education, which is, and it's right watching over the years, where you go, well, here's the statistics and here's the deal and we've doubled spending and what do we have to show for it and all that other sort of stuff. So thanks for the flashback, Ira. I appreciate that. I want to spend just a couple of minutes on an update for the 115th Congress, which cranked up the third of this month. And then I'm going to kind of open it up for questions and answers since it's kind of a fertile time for opinions about what's going on in Washington, D.C. And, of course, depending on what news you watch in the mornings, you can, you know, pretty much do the Burger King thing, have it your way. If you want to hear what a bad guy Donald Trump is, you can go to CNN, you can go to MSNBC, you can read the New York Times. If you're mad at the Democrats, we can go to Fox. And if you really want the news, you're kind of left with going to BBC. Which is an interesting thing. But anyhow, we hit the ground running, have started the process of the of starting to get rid of or amend the health care law, colloquially known as the Affordable Care Act. The Senate's busy. Senator Heller was in Eureka and Ely for the start of the Lincoln Days stuff this last weekend. And then is back today. They're actually doing Ryan Zinke, a colleague of mine, who President Trump nominated to head the Department of Interior, and the lady who's going to be the Secretary of Education. They're both up in front of the Senate today, and they've got some more folks going on in that sort of stuff. And obviously, Friday's the big day. Put your hand on the Bible and get sworn in. For those of you wondering, I will not be there. And you say, well, what's that all about? And it's like, with all due respect, the opportunity to be outside in Washington, D.C. in January for 4 hours with several hundred thousand of your closest and most personal friends is not my idea of a good time of a Friday morning in Washington, D.C. No disrespect to the president or the vice president, but it's like, hey, we're going to have a thank you thing for contributors in the campaign. Across town, going to have a big screen TV, have a little breakfast, watch it at 9 o'clock. These folks will be back in their back at their offices by 10:30 at the latest, and nobody will have had to invest in electric socks, antihistamines, or anything else like that. Maybe when I was younger, it would have been a good idea, but the president seems to be doing okay without me at all of his events, so we're going to hope that this lasts for one more. So anyhow, I think the present score, the way things are set up back there, we've got 238 or 42 or something. I think 238 folks in the House. The rules in the House are pretty easy. You need 218 to pass a bill. In the House, the side with the most votes wins. It's kind of like gang warfare in a little more rarefied atmosphere. Senate has some different rules, although under recently retired Harry Reid, for purposes of confirming nominees, they only need 51 to confirm those folks. So the whole 60-vote filibuster stuff doesn't apply for the folks that the president has nominated for his cabinet. preliminary indications are with the folks that have gone first is they've done well, despite what you may have heard or read in terms of how they're laying in wait for them and they're going to murder them on this and that and the other sort of thing. It's like, hey, his nominees are doing well, and so far, no surprises. Within a couple months, I expect you'll see a Supreme Court name being floated out there for Judge Alito's or Judge Scalia's. Yeah, no offense, Judge Alito. Well, maybe, but anyhow. You'll see that out there within a couple of months. The most interesting day, I think, will be Friday, though, because the president's plans are to do the swearing in, do a little bit of the parade. Then he's going straight down to his new office and, you know, starting to sign. So I'm sure if the, I'm sure if there was some concern about who he was or wasn't hanging out with Russia and where they were going to the bathroom during things that didn't happen that were put out as this isn't news, but it's out there, then they'll absolutely be apoplectic by the time the sun goes down in Reno Friday night. So I'm sure he'll need a couple of pin refills just before he even goes to a couple of the balls. But other than that, I kind of want to open it up because I know the membership of this group is kind of mamby-pamby. You don't have strong feelings about anything, which is why Ira struggled so much trying to kind of find something that he felt strongly about while I was here. So anyhow, I thought I'd open it up and just kind of let you folks attack. Yes, sir.
Could you, here's the I'll bring it on. Who wants to ask the first question?
Gentleman in the back.
We can record it and hear it.
Oh, hey, sorry, I picked you, but evidently I don't get a pick, so fire away.
Congressman?
Yes?
What are we going to do about Obama stealing the land?
Oh, the the monument stuff. Interesting thing, you know, actually we've got a bill in that says unless the state legislature approves it and the governor, you can't do that. The creation of monuments, yeah, it's like, God forbid there be public input. And you know, here's the thing. People disagree about land use. I mean, you go down to the city council or county commission, somebody wants to rezone a corner to do an AM, PM, or they want to do multifamily, or whatever. People get engaged about their neighborhoods and their regions. That's nothing new. But there's a public process so you can talk about it. I've been criticized. I know this is hard for you to believe. I've been criticized by the Reno Gazette Journal about putting in some bills to transfer federal land to private and local and state ownership. And so when those bills go forward, you know, there's been letters to the editor like, oh my God, blah, blah, blah. It's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I introduced a bill that went through the legislature, got a resolution that supported it. NACO, the Nevada Association of Counties, supported it. We introduced it in the 114th Congress, which, by the way, shut down December 31st. So guess what? You got to start all over again. So it's not like anything's out there imminent. It got a hearing. God forbid you have a hearing on a bill in the United States Congress if somebody has an idea. I feel real bad about that, trying to sneak something in like that. I feel, you know, and it's like, shame on you counties, because right now, Washoe County, Pershing County, the folks at Lovelock, down Douglas County, Lake Tahoe, Minden, Gardnerville, they all have lands bills pending. And anybody here ever hear of a town called Las Vegas? You know, there's this thing that they've been doing down there for about 30 years, Southern Nevada Public Lands Management Act. Tens of thousands of acres of public land were sold at public auction privately to people who allowed the town to grow, if that's what the Clark County Commission, the Henderson City Council, the Las Vegas City Council decided to do. And it's like, well, it's wonderful down there. I mean, heck, some of the proceeds go up here to do stuff at Tahoe and stuff like that. All a hugely public process, all pursuant to bills that were passed by both houses of Congress and signed by whoever the president was. And then you've got the monuments thing. Oh, we're having a news conference in 2 days. Guess what? An area the size of Rhode Island is now a national monument. Now, let's be honest. Nobody thinks national monuments are bad things. The one called Basin and Range has this artist guy who's been doing, and I know a lot of you read my column on art every week when it comes out. Let me know what it says. But anyhow, absolutely no public input. News to the county commissions. News to the State Department of Conservation and Natural Resources. Folks that do things like fish and game and the Department of Environmental Protection and the forestry folks and the water folks, all that. It's like, well, didn't we need to talk to any of the state resource folks? God forbid you talk to a county commissioner in any of the counties that are affected by, in that instance, 800 plus thousand acres. But if you're somebody who's saying, you know, they might bring a train to Yucca Mountain that way, so let's just close off that whole 800,000 acres. Here's the irony. Monument designations are the equivalent of an executive order. So if Congress decides to go forward with, for instance, Yucca Mountain, and they provide a right-of-way for rail service from wherever across, they can do that. Guess what? Publicly passed laws in the U.S. Congress signed by the president take precedence over an executive order. So you're sitting going, it isn't even effective for that. If those folks in those other 49 states decide to send a train from the CP or the Burlington Northern or whatever down from the north through there, guess what? They're going to provide a right-of-way for it. So you're like, what have we done? And by the way, there are some folks, well, it's good for monuments are good for the economy. Okay, where's your data? Well, here it is. So there's a report out by an outfit. And I don't know how to say this to you instead of just whack you with it. Not a single piece of the study dealt with any monuments in the state of Nevada. You're like, well, where's the Nevada data? I mean, let's forget monuments. Let's talk about national parks. We've got one, Great Basin National Park over in White Pine County. We're proud of it. We've got some national recreation areas, that sort of stuff. It's like, listen, that's a cliche that doesn't have any foundation in Nevada, with all due respect. And then when you read the actual report, it says things like, hey, I decided to wear gray today because the sky's gray. And everybody knows that on Tuesdays, if you wear gray, your joints don't hurt when you get to be older. What did he say? Oh, it's a fact. I just made it up, but it's a fact. That's what you get for a lot of that stuff. And so we've introduced a bill that says, hey, if it's over, as I recall, it's like if it's over 5,000 acres, you got to have legislative approval. God forbid people elected to serve in the legislature, you know, who stand for election in Ira's case or my case every 2 years, be accountable to people for what they vote for, as opposed to signing this and there you go. So there'll be some momentum for it. There's a little bit of, because we're Republicans and Republicans love intramurals, there's a little bit of a tussle going on right now because Rob Bishop, who I refer to as the Dean of the West, represents a district in Utah, says, hey, we don't want a Westerner to be the prime sponsor on the bill. We want an Easterner. And I'm like, I mean, I think the world of Rob, but it's like, well, why is that? And he says, well, we don't want people to think it's a Western issue. It's like, it is a Western issue. With all due respect, Mr. Chairman. But I think we've got that stuff kind of worked out. And so it'll be an interesting time to watch. Because I'll tell you what, it's a challenging time for the West. You know, I'm not the smartest guy in the room, but if you give me enough time, sometimes I figure some things out. We have about 22 seats in the Intermountain West in the U.S. House of Representatives. Good folks. But you look at that compared to the, you know, that's 10% of the Republican conference, not quite 10%. And so when you talk about issues that we live with every day, and you're talking to your colleagues going, hey, we need this or we need that or whatever, and they're kind of looking at you like, huh? The education factor for colleagues in your own party, much less the other parties, is quite a distinct challenge in terms of, because they have no concept of what it's like to say, hey, we want to do this project or we want to promote energy exploration or we want to promote renewables or we want to promote anything. It's like, well, in most instances, you have to go get the permission of folks are stationed here, but who ultimately work for somebody 2,500 miles away that none of us voted for. No disrespect, Sally Jewell. Ryan Zinke, great guy, colleague from Montana, going to be the next Secretary of the Interior, I think. And actually, one of the ideas that that's being kicked around is moving BLM headquarters to Salt Lake City. And I think it'll be just hilarious to watch people go apoplectic. You know, it's like, well, I mean, what if we had to actually go to the area that's kind of the center of where most of our acreage is? Yeah, it might be kind of close to those people that you're saying. Well, anyhow, I won't finish that sentence, but. So anyhow, we've got a bill going that I think will get, quite frankly, will get out of the House. And then it'll be Senator Heller and his pals over in the Senate. Lisa Murkowski from Alaska is the head of their resources committee over there. So we'll see. We'll see how that goes. But let me just tell you this. There's a window now in the change of administrations that's 6-9 months long. It could be longer, but I'm pretty sure there's one that's 6 or 9 months long. And so to get those balls rolling and moving is, I think, very important in terms, at least in my analysis, for Western issues. That's things doing with Sachin. That's things doing with monuments. That's things doing with lands bills. That's things doing with waters of the U.S. All those things that make it much more complex for somebody to explore, whether it's energy, development, whatever it is. So it's going to be an interesting time. But we've got a bill that's aimed at stopping that practice. Final piece real quick. If you look at the history of that, it was meant initially to be small scale. You know, somebody was getting ready to put a bulldozer through a bunch of hieroglyphics or you know, knock down the Sequoia Redwoods or something like that, where it's like, okay. But it's since become a political club that we used to beat the heck out of predominantly Western states with. Who's next?
By the way, you might want to do a smackdown on that Band-Aid. You got an extra collar going there.
Well, that's that knife fight I got in earlier today. But I was allowed to bring a gun to a knife fight. So after the terrorist cut me a couple times, I just shot him and stopped by Walgreens on the way in.
You got it. So just got to
be alive. Might as well be a Whopper, huh?
Two things, just an Amodei story and a comment. So on election night, about 400 of us down here, we're going, wow. So that night, I'd like to hear a story from you and your colleagues, what you guys were talking about around 6 p.m. on election night. And second thing, is Donald Trump kicking ass or taking names? What do you guys think in his first 100 days here before he was elected?
You know, I'll do the second one first. First of all, this is just my opinion. Nobody voted for Donald Trump because they thought he was a teddy bear. We wanted somebody to run the outfit. And I mean, I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but it's like, no, he's like, God, he's such a soft, cuddly guy. And I really want to give him a chance. Like, hey, we want somebody to get out there on the tip of the spear and lead, follower, get the out of the way. So when you talk about the first 100 days, I it was one of the commentators in the last month that said, listen, I think what drives this guy, I mean, let's face it, there's a rumor that Donald Trump has an ego. I don't know if it's true or not. But there's a rumor that he's got an ego. But he said, that's what will drive this guy to relentlessly pursue and obtain what he said he would do. Because if he doesn't, he has to come to grips with the fact that I didn't do what I said I was going to do. Now, what he said he was going to do and what he does may matriculate a little bit. But essentially, this is a guy who I think is wired to where it's like, I want to be able to say, I delivered on that, I delivered on that, I delivered on. I mean, look at what's already going on with the jobs thing. Hey, I straightened those Ford guys out, and I didn't, I've been at a couple other things, but maybe he's straightened GM out, although he needs to give them back to the shareholders and the bondholders. And with all due respect, so it's not Government Motors anymore, in my humble opinion. But anyhow, so I think that drives him a lot. So you're going to see, I'll tell you a concern that is, it's like, listen, healthcare. By the way, Republicans, Donald Trump, the House of Representatives, and the Republicans in the United States Senate now own health care. Yeah. Well, you're clapping now. It's like, But I say that to say, you know, well, you know, it's kind of like when Barack Obama was blaming George Bush for things, you know, 7.5 years into his term. It's like, seriously. But anyhow, having said that, healthcare is one of those issues that has a lot of moving parts. I think, quite frankly, the Republicans, at least in the House, made a mistake. Instead of for the last 5 years just saying it sucks, it sucks, it sucks, we should have been having hearings on health savings accounts, having hearings on clinics, having hearings on hospitals, pharma, all that stuff, because there's a lot of moving parts in there, especially in a state like ours, where we have access problems, even in Las Vegas. You know, when they went through the veterans thing and said, hey, listen, let veterans go anywhere they want. It's like, well, that's fine with me. But in this town, you talk about how long it takes to get in to see a doctor for a lot of things and compare with what the VA list is, and it's like, you can go anywhere you want, but I'm not sure, you know, going downtown is going to speed it up over what's going on over at the VA hospital. So I say all that, and it's like the challenge for this is okay, we've started the process of repealing the Affordable Care Act, but you've got to make sure. Remember when they first rolled it out and the disaster that the whole internet stuff was? And let me tell you what, I signed up for the Nevada plan. Now, I know it might come as a shock to some people in this room. I had help signing up. And even with help, 2 weeks. I wasn't asking, it's like, hey, this is the plan I want. I want the silver plan. Here's how much it costs. Oh, my God. But anyhow, you know, payroll deduction, the whole nine yards, 2 weeks. So it's like, hey, guess what? It needs to be done. It's not something that in my mind, because guess what part of the problem of the existing one was? It was done behind closed doors. It was done with you know, staff brainstorming, and a couple people got in, most people didn't. If you, Paul Ryan, and Mitch McConnell do that same thing, you're idiots, because you're going to get the same result. You better have some hearings and try and get this right and talk about timing that works. The 2017 benefit year is already in the books. You better be talking about 2018. Use 2017. You got to have hearings all day into the night, and on Saturday and Sunday, do it. But be more thoughtful. But on other areas, I think you're going to see blowing and going, which is a good thing. Some of this stuff will take time. You know what? Foreign relations is something that's going to take time. You don't undo what's been done in the last two terms overnight, but I think he's got some good people to do it. On election night, Here's kind of how it went. Since most of the guys that I talk to are Ohio and Pennsylvania folks, and you're sitting here going, well, you know, we're going to see what's going on in Florida and then North Carolina. If those go the wrong way, it's like you can go to bed early. And so, you know, it took a little while to call Florida. They didn't really call North Carolina, and all of a sudden they go, yeah, things are looking pretty good in Ohio. And so I'm texting my guys in Pennsylvania. Because they're going, Donald Trump's going to win Pennsylvania. And I'm going, well, yeah, I know you got to say that. But it's like, you know, that Philadelphia and that Pittsburgh things, they're kind of, you know, it's kind of like that Las Vegas thing is here. And so anyhow, it gets to a point where Lou Barletta, former mayor of Hazen, Pennsylvania, represents District 11. He says, I don't know why the networks aren't calling, but he's 30,000 votes ahead right now. Now, 30,000 in Pennsylvania is not a huge number. But 30,000 in terms of, is it a cliffhanger? Are we looking for hanging chads or whatever, is a big number. And so finally, when they started going, okay, he's got Ohio, he's got they call Pennsylvania, and then they start looking at Michigan and Wisconsin. I mean, these guys are all doing backflips, you know, like, hey, we told you. And of course, then they go, what the hell happened in Nevada? I said, well, he won my district. Didn't win Washoe County, but he won my district. So anyhow, it was one of those things where I actually did, you know, since it wasn't outside in January for 4 hours, I actually did stay up most of the night and go, you know what, I don't think you're going to see something like this ever again. I want to watch every single minute. Although I missed some of the commentators crying. And anyhow, who's next? Yes. Thank you for your patience.
You betcha. Whoa. First, the comment. I think the Trump thing, what people try to envision him as either a Democrat or a Republican. He's a businessman. Businessmen and businesses have to produce results or they don't survive. Yeah. Everything Trump will do will be based on business. My question is, in business, if you have a problem, you develop critical success factors, you develop goals and objectives, and then you do metrics to measure it. Why doesn't Congress attach to every bill critical success factors, goals and objectives, metrics, and a sunset clause if it's not meeting the metrics?
Well, you know that's a good question. But before you get to that highly refined thing, I got to tell you, just speaking for me, it's like we need to go back to the part where they have, and I'm not going to swear because I'm trying to do better on that this year, where they have hearings. And you say, what did he just say? And I got to tell you, right now, you look at it, you say, well, okay, you got committees. I'm on appropriations. We do the spending. So everybody comes with their budgets before us. And if we want to, it's going to be kind of interesting now that you got a Republican administration, because we've all been trained on how to, you know, get Eric Holder and get Janet Reno and get Paul Costigan in the IRS and all that other sort of stuff and cut. And now it's like, okay, so these guys are supposedly and girls are supposedly on the same team. But let me tell you what, we go through all that. The last 2 years, appropriations has passed all 12 of the appropriations bills to fund the government. You know what difference it made? None. Because you know why? They didn't bring them to the floor. So we ended up with continuing resolutions and omnibuses. And you're going, what am I pedaling the bike around this track for if you're just going to go over there in the clubhouse and go like this? You look at a lot of the resource issues where you go, hey, when is natural resources going to have a hearing? Immigration. When is judiciary going to do hearings? When I was on immigration, we did hearings, passed 5 bills out to the floor, never saw the light of day on the floor. It's a phrase called regular order. So before you get to, hey, you want these metrics, and Kevin McCarthy, the majority leader, is a big metrics guy. It's like, you know, first of all, you got to actually commit to spending the time on the floor, allowing that process to go forward. Sometimes there's a zillion amendments, but that's the nature of the beast, especially on the south side of the building, the House of Representatives. And so I would invite you all to watch that, because as we sit here and do this healthcare thing, it's like if they're not, there's 3 major committees with jurisdiction, Ways and Means, because they've got some revenue related stuff. Energy and Commerce is the main healthcare committee. And then the third one is, I think they've got some in budget because it affects, you know, if you're going to keep the government as the single payer, I hope not. Then you've got all 3 of those. It's like, so I went in before I came back on Friday night and said to Ways and Means, I go, hey, how many committee hearings you got scheduled in the next 2 months? What's the topic? Oversight. Really? So you're talking about tax reform and you're talking about healthcare reform and you have 1 committee hearing scheduled on oversight. So, good idea. As a matter of fact, I'll suggest that. Say, hey, how do we measure this stuff? But I'll tell you what the response is going to be. Well, that would assume that we're passing individual bills and kind of doing regular order. And you say, well, why aren't you guys doing that? And you know what my short answer is? Laziness and egos. I'm the head girl. I'm the head guy. Let's just do this. Here's your 3 days notice. How are you going to vote on it? You know the old Nancy Pelosi thing? You got to pass it so you can read it. And you're like, no, that didn't work so good where I come from. We're not passing them and reading them. So we'll see. There's some challenges. You know, there was something this morning about Speaker Ryan's talking about tax reform and these whatever borders on the tariff stuff. What are they? Movable borders or something is the euphemism they're using. And they're like, oh yeah, we're in lockstep with Pence and Trump on that. Well, somebody from the Wall Street Journal interviews Trump and he's like, I don't think so. And you're kind of going, oh boy. One more? No more?
I know some might have to leave, and there's a lot of questions. We want Mark and Ira, Jeff, to answer questions. But in all fairness, just a couple of things. We're going to do the 50-50 drawing, so everybody has a chance. It's $81. And before I do that, because I really, Mark gets going, and Ira, they do a great job. I want you to stay, ask questions, okay? But Patty Miller has been waiting. We have Lincoln Day coming up February 25th. And just real briefly, I pass out some cards. I have these little cards for the wine. If you donate wine $20 and up, that's part of the drawing. Patty, real quickly, and there are flyers.
Thank you, Ray. Gee, I didn't think I could preempt to Congressman. This is pretty exciting. As Ray said, my name is Patty Miller, and I am coordinating the Lincoln Day Dinner this year, which probably all of you know is the major fundraiser for the Washoe County GOP. Many of you are already signed up, so thank you. For the rest of you, I want to share a couple exciting things. It's scheduled for the last Saturday of February on the 25th. It's here at the Atlantis. The last few years, it's been at the Peppermill, so we're trying the Atlantis this year. I'm really excited about the menu, petite filet mignon, salmon Wellington, eggplant parmesan. So we're trying to do upscale a bit. And are you ready? We have some national speakers that are really exciting. So I think you're going to want to come. One is Jonathan Gilliam. You may have seen him on Fox News or CNN if you ever turn the channel there. He was a Navy SEAL, a Ranger. He was in the FBI. He was a federal marshal. So he has a very interesting background. He has his own radio show. He's going to be here. Jessie Jane Duff is a Marine vet. She also is seen on major TV channels and radio shows. If you went to the last Trump rally before the election when John Voight was in town, she was one of the speakers at that event. She's fantastic. Our state controller, Ron Connect, is going to come and share his version of the state of the state. So I hope you all decide to come. If you are so inclined, you can even buy a table and invite some friends. We have sponsorships. And just one last quick thing, because I know you want me to sit down. If you can't come, but you'd like to support the party, there's all sorts of things you can do. For $65, you can sponsor a student or a vet to attend, which would be a nice gesture. Last year, we had about 20 students and vets attend that otherwise would not have been able to. Ray passed around some cards. You can simply donate a bottle of wine, a nice bottle of wine, because we're going to do a wine drawing. You could make a donation of any size. Of course, we'd be happy to take whatever you would be generous enough to donate. So I have some flyers with information. If you're so excited about this, like me, that you want to register today, just put your name and contact information on the flyer and hand it to me, and I will follow up with you to get the rest of the information. Or you can go online on the Washoe GOP site. It's www.washoegop.org. And there's an online, easy way to register, and you can pay there or you can write a check. So, did I cover everything? Thank you.
I'll say one more thing. You think I bug you with 10 or more emails. Wait, she gets a hold of you. And I'm the one sending out a lot of the emails. Just real briefly, and we're going to have questions. Did you all get the flyer? Our next meeting, John Sanchez, February 25th. It's also a luncheon. It's on those flyers I handed out, or when you came in. Right now, we're going to have Alexis Hansen. She's going to draw the $81 and see who's the lucky winner.
Okay, the last four digits, 4443. 4443. Oh, there we are. Oh, it's Ken.
Mark said, you don't get it. You're rich, get richer. Yeah, you can contribute to his new campaign, huh? There you go. Like I said, pick up those flyers. next meeting. I wanted to mention one thing, too, before we ask questions, because I know several of you did. May Herbert is really a good sponsor. She's with Ambassadors of Goodwill. She gave each of them pins, including myself. She has a function coming up this Friday. It's kind of a private thing. But she does a great job. She's met everybody from Reagan on down. All right, next. You heard the whole spiel. The other one is Ellie Malian is with the Americans for Prosperity. They have a thing coming up the last Friday of the month. It's policy and procedures at River Grill. Huh? Well, I mentioned one. Okay. Well, real quickly. And then for
all right. Thanks, Ray. We have our Policy in a Plate luncheon next Friday. It's at 11. It's at the Wild River Grill. We will have two speakers. Robert Eithoven will be there with the NRA. And then we will have a city councilwoman from Reno coming to speak about the floods and the impact on our fellow citizens. And then Wednesday, the 25th, there's a school choice event in Carson City at the legislature. We would really like it if people could attend, show our legislators how important it is to you guys that school choice actually happens and gets passed. I would say go talk to Ira, but he's already on our side. So if you have any questions, I have cards. Please come and talk to me. Thank you very much.
There's one last one. Paul Jackson wanted to mention about First Friday. Hurry up. And then we'll go back to asking questions.
Okay, First Friday is where Republicans and conservatives go to have fun. It's going to be at Knockouts on Moana. Everybody know where that is? It's easy to find. The food's free, the drinks are cheap, and the crowd's fun. That's all you need. No. First Friday of next month.
That's in February. All right, with that, Jim, you're the next one, I think, to add a question. Go ahead.
Broke. Oh, no, it's
closer. Can you just say it?
What is it?
Okay. Two-part question. There are two pending pro-gun bills right now in Congress, and I believe both were initiated by Congressman Hudson, if I'm not mistaken. The first one is national reciprocity, which this bill has been introduced forever, and it dies every year, never goes anywhere, because states like California, New York, Connecticut, et cetera, just kill it, wouldn't have anything to do with it. I don't know if this looks more promising to you this time around. The second bill is called the Hearing Protection Act. Yeah. Are you familiar with what that is?
Yeah, the silencers.
Okay. Well, it's suppressors. I'm really excited about this, both of these bills. So do you know the details on these? And if so, what are your chances of success?
The national reciprocity one, I think, is one that there shouldn't be a problem in the House. And listen, I'm not picking on the Senate. I just don't spend time over there. So I could make something up and speculate, but put the biggest grain of salt you can find with it. The hearing protection one, we were just talking about that in the office this week. And I'm not sure, since this is the first time that's come up. Did Richard Hudson introduce that one too?
I believe so.
From North Carolina?
I believe so.
Yeah. So anyhow, that's one where it's like, I guess it'll go in front of judiciary. I don't know. It's a new concept. I am just aware of it in terms of silencers being, I mean, you can get a silencer now, or a suppressor, or whatever I'm supposed to be calling
it. In some states, you just do your right paperwork.
That's you have to pay more money and stuff like that. But, this, I assume that the bill would make it so it's like anybody could get one if they wanted one, to whatever the existing rules are. But that one's kind of a first impression. So. Okay. We'll do our homework on it and look at it, but we're in the same spot we have been on national reciprocity. Yep. Hey, but by the way, real quick, since we're talking about that, this last election cycle, real fast, it's, you know, I'm kind of like, hey, we don't run negative ads and we take the high road and we talk about why we think you should rehire us and stuff like that. And this last cycle, my opponent was out there saying some mean things about me. And so I'm sitting there going, okay, you got to be a grown-up person and you got to blah, 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 and you're not going to get down. And I didn't, but there was a point about 2 weeks before early voting where some of my lug nuts were starting to get a little loose, if you know what I mean. You know, it's like, I'm going to go find out where that guy lives and egg his house or something. I got to bring this home to, but I found the antidote to kind of, so I went to, who's the crazy guy from Israel on Kitsky Lane? Sharon, I run into him at something and I says, hey, I was at the gun show and this and that. He goes, why are you dealing with people in the gun show when you should be trading with local? And I go, well, do you got it? And he goes, yeah. So I go in there to see it. Needless to say, I bought my meat gun when I was growing up was an Ithaca Model 37 Featherlight shotgun because I'm a lefty and it ejected out of the bottom. Not that shells flying across my face did anything to ruin my aim. It was what it was, no matter what. He had one that was new in the box, never fired. I says, well, I'll be by to see it. So I look at it and it's like, geez, it's kind of neat. It's still, it's just like he said it was. And then I says, hey, while I'm here, you got any of those Beretta over under, you know, model 686 silver pigeons or whatever? Because everything I'm looking at in his place has got black composite. I'm going, he doesn't have any of those pretty guns with wood stocks. Sure enough, he had some. So anyhow, about 30 minutes later, I walk out with about $3,000 worth of guns that I didn't need. And it was like, okay, I feel better now. I think I can make it through the last month of the election without choking the out of somebody. Next, yes.
I got so excited about that. I didn't know what was going on.
Yes, sir.
On this Obamacare Act that we hopefully will be repealing, will add up with no replacement. I don't think the government needs to be in the business of health insurance, and I don't think we, the people, need to have the government helping me out with anything. So, you know, I do enough just by contributing to represents salaries. So that should be enough. I don't think we need to go for replacement. You know, there's a whole bunch of people out there that will sell insurance. Government doesn't need to be in that business. So when you go back there, just say no.
Yeah. Okay, Nancy Reagan, that's what I'll do. But, you know, that brings up one of the things where you say, listen, do we need healthcare reform? Yeah. But that was a function of cost and insurance operations. You know, it was this whole thing said, hey, we're going to take it over because they have an abiding thought that the only way you insure everybody is to create one mega group administered by the federal government. And so that, and that's kind of, you know, the thing that IRA fights in the state legislature is if your starting premise is that we're 51 because we don't spend enough money, I disagree with your premise. But if you go forward on that, it's like, well, how do we get more money? It's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And so with healthcare, it's the same thing in terms of how do we fix the market? You know, when this started, although Nevada was higher, there were 11% of people nationwide uninsured. How do you take care of that? You don't, well, I don't know all X million of them. I'm just saying, how do you address that issue without blowing up the other 89% when you need reforms or whatever? So that wasn't the predicate to me saying, therefore, you should all get in a government health care program. Don't cut me off again like that, by God. I can get that shit in Washington, D.C. But anyhow, so that's going to be the challenge. I was like, well, we all know that the government should run it. It's like wrong first sentence. So that will be interesting to see, which is kind of why I'm saying you better have some hearings. Because if you drop a bill that says the federal government's still going to be in charge of it all, it's like, and if I get fired for voting no, I'll accept that. But it's like, I'm not voting to keep these guys and girls in the healthcare business. But then you get into Medicaid rates and Medicare reimbursement and CMS or whatever. I mean, these guys are worse than... So anyhow, there's a lot of work to be done. It can be done expeditiously, but don't skip doing the work and be transparent about it. Yes.
Yeah, aside from big ranchers,
Wasn't my idea to have you stand up, so.
Aside from big ranchers, how will Nevadans, if you could just summarize, how will Nevadans benefit from taking on the liabilities of BLM land?
Well, first of all, some of you may be in the real estate business. And if you look at the proposal in our last bill said that they wanted 17 million acres. Okay. 10 of it was to stay in state ownership and 7 of it was to be available for sale. So you say, well, okay, 17 million acres, that's a lot. Here's your first fact. 75% of the state of Nevada would still be owned by the Department of Interior. So when you say we're taking it on, it's like, well, we're going to either state or private land, doubling that from about 12, 13% to around 25%. So this sweeping generalization out here that Nevada is going to become some private state, it's like 75% of it's still going to be federal. But then you have to look and you say, well, where are these lands? And you say, well, the first 7 million, which is supposed to be sold. And by the way, when you hear the phrase supposed to be sold, we did the Lincoln County Land Act like 10 or 12 years ago in the U.S. Congress. I wasn't there. It allowed them to sell, I think it was 100,000 acres as part of it. It passed. You know how much of that 100,000 acres is sold? Less than 1,000. And you say, why are you telling me that? I'm telling you that because the authorization to sell 7 million doesn't mean the market can absorb 7 million. But when you say, well, then why do you want it to begin with? Two answers. First, in the 6 BLM district offices around the state, in their resource management plans, they've identified lands in each Reno's in the Carson district, in each district that are land suitable for sale. Now, these are the feds saying, suitable for sale. What is that? Well, it's the 40-acre parcel that's up off the end of Moana. It's the 160-acre parcel that's out, you know, in the flood zone on the other side of Sparks. It's the checkerboard along I-80 that, you know, when you got every other section. So it's all those sorts of things. But the general answer is this. It's the same sort of stuff that if you want to grow in the way that your county commission or city council, regardless of the county you live in, decides they want to grow because you elected them to make those planning and zoning decisions, you have the ability to do it without waiting 10 years for a land law to pass through the Congress. So you say, well, maybe I don't want them to grow. Well, look at what's going on in Lincoln County. They've sold 1,000 acres in 10 years. Now, I don't think that would happen in Washoe County, but that is part of the deal where you say, hey, these are the people that are elected to control their own destiny. You know, Sparks wants 40 acres for a cemetery. I got to pass a public lands bill to get them 40 acres for a cemetery? So anyhow, if the premise is, hey, what are we going to do with the responsibility for all this stuff? First of all, as those sell, the bill says, here's what you're going to use the money for. It goes for education, Ira. More money. Good thing. Yeah, right. But anyhow, part of that is that you get money to administer those. And by the way, there's also the thing that happens when they go out of federal ownership and they go on your county tax rolls and generate things like property taxes and the ability of people to engage in commerce for whatever that is, whether it's energy production, whether it's minerals production, whether it's development, whether it's whatever. So the concept of there's a bill out there that says Nevada's now going to become privately owned or owned by the state and not the federal government is simply inaccurate. But if you think that even that level of, then fine, that's fine with me. It's America. Say, hey, I just don't want anything to transfer. Okay, that's honest. As opposed to, oh, you're going to cut off my access or we can't afford it or whatever. Part of the reason these folks, the legislature approved the resolution, did it, there was a whole economic study done on it. Not that it's, you know, it's like look through it, see if you agree with it or not. But the process where we got to where we're discussing it or a bill has been introduced has not been one where somebody got up one day and went, let's see if we can get 17 million acres from the feds while nobody's looking. So we're going to introduce the bill again, and that'll mean there's another hearing. And where that goes from there, I don't know. Other Western states are going to be doing the same thing. But I find it interesting in a state where the largest commercial area in the state has gotten to be what it's gotten to be because of of a federal lands bill that allows direct auction to private people for development, tens of thousands of acres. And when you talk about, well, there's other areas that need to be taken care of in terms of letting the state manage. And listen, what it's really about is letting the state manage its own economic destiny. That's really the bottom line. And that's through its county commissions and its state departments, which is what, you know, Texas is an interesting state. They go, well, you know, less than 1% of Texas is owned by the federal government. Not that we want to be Texas. Heck, even California is like 40%. Utah's in the high 60s. We would still be the highest percentage, even more than Alaska, federally owned state in the nation. If this bill was law yesterday. Who else? Did that answer your question?
One more. We'll do one more. Maybe two. But if you have to leave, we understand. And Ira's here, they'll stay.
We'll get a hold of John Ferrari. He won't charge any of you guys for parking.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
Good. Can we get the labor unions out of government? And Ira's presentation, he pointed to the point where the school system went into a downward spiral in Nevada, which coincidentally was about the time the teachers union took over the schools. At the federal level, this began in the early 60s with a Kennedy executive order. Can we get President Trump to rescind that executive order and get the SEIU and all their buddies gone?
You know, that's, I haven't specifically looked at where he's at on that issue. It's an interesting thought for a guy who's built a lot of buildings in New York City. And I don't say that because I know, but I guess let me see if I can do some homework on if there's anything out there that he said during the election. His labor, his Secretary of Labor, you heard me mention Lou Barletta before, who's a colleague of mine. Barletta was one of the first guys in Pennsylvania to get on the Trump wagon. And his background is in highway construction. So he wanted to be Secretary of Transportation. And Barletta was one of the first guys to go up to the Trump Tower in New York after the election. It's like, oh, Lou's going up there. He's going to talk to Trump about, you know, Secretary of Transportation and blah, blah, blah. So he goes up there and he comes back and it's like, so how'd it go? And he walks in and he says, and so Priebus is there, Pence is there, Bannon, the policy guy's there, Trump's there. And the first thing they kind of tell him is, hey, McConnell's wife is going to be Secretary of Transportation. We want you to be Secretary of Labor. Which kind of like, and so he says, can I think about it? Which probably in hindsight was a mistake. Because I think one of the reasons Ryan Zinke's going to be secretary, he says, yes, sir, absolutely, I'm in. But anyway, I says, can I think about it? So he comes back and you know, I'm like, so you're going to be like Jimmy Hoffa? I mean, you guys from the East or? You guys are all in the tank for the unions, aren't you? I mean, come on, you all talk like this. So he thinks about it for a few days. He calls Priebus back, and he says, I've thought about it. I'm going to take the job. I accept your offer. And Priebus goes, geez, that's great, Lou. That'd be great to have you, you know, blah, 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 all this stuff. He goes, I don't want you to think that I'm saying bad things about the boss, but you need to know that sometimes he promises the same thing to two people. You're like, you know, I'm not sure what that means, but I think I might have an idea. And so Barletta says, so I started doing some homework on who my competition is. And so I forget the guy's name. He's the designate for the Secretary of Labor, though, but he's like a zillionaire. He was a big contributor to the campaign. He was on his Council of Economic Advisors. And he owns Carl's Jr. and Hardee's. And so after hearing that, I go, hey, Lou, you're screwed. And you know what? For once, I was right. But I don't know what that guy's background is, why he was in the running for that, or whatever. But I think that would tell you something in terms of where he may be heading on some of on some of those things. But I'll just tell you this. I mean, my record on those things, a lot of the stuff we tried to do in the VA, we were opposed by SEIU. And it's like, come on, guys, seriously? I mean, and it's like, yep. So I think the challenge in the whole union thing is this. Nobody's against fairness or safety, but political agendas, whether they're in education or they're in VA healthcare or whatever, really don't match up good with those missions. And so the only thing I don't know, which is interesting, we'll have to find out, is what Trump's relationship was in the private sector with unions when it came to construction and stuff like that. One more. Where was
it? Right here.
Mark, the people, us, we voted for Trump.
Yep.
Trump beat 16 of our best politicians.
Yep.
And he beat them fair and square.
Yep.
Yes, he had to call one a liar. He had to call one short or little. We've all been that way. But he is the choice. We lost a senator because he came out publicly and didn't want to support Trump. We are about, I think, to lose another senator if he doesn't get off his ass and support him.
Yeah.
I must compliment you, because although you liked Cruz and other people.
No. Cruz was the only guy I didn't endorse.
Well, it shows you how much I want you.
I single-handedly killed every presidential candidate from the state of Florida.
Okay. At any rate, you saw the writing on the wall, and you supported him fully, and even became his campaign manager in Nevada. Whether it worked or not is not important. But one of these two guys is going to swallow their own ego and support who the party wants. Because I was amazed in the conservative circles that we work in here, everyone was on board and on board early because they wanted a winner.
Well, and listen, I think we had the conversation. Everybody goes, hey, thanks for sticking. And I go, hey, I'm not a great guy. I just have this abiding belief that this is a team sport. And so after I killed Bush and then moved and killed Rubio quickly after that, I said, hey, I'll support the nominee. I will support the nominee. And I'll tell you, kind of the thought process was this. Joe Heck called me that Friday that came out. And he says, hey, Hardy and I are going to be at a thing with Romney and Heller tomorrow, and we're going to, in the morning, and we're going to, and I said, hey, Joe, you do what you need to. You've been doing okay without any political advice from me. Here are my thoughts. First of all, this is the most divisive cycle I can recall. And I said, so I think even if you say I hate Donald Trump, there's not a single Democrat that's going to go, okay, then I'm voting for you for United States Senate. Second of all, the speed at which you do this will be as important as what you ultimately decide to do. If before brunch is done tomorrow, you're gone. I said, it just kind of feels like a windsock. Oh, shit, there's lead in the air. I'm out of here sort of thing. And people want people that are going to stay the course. And I said, the third thing is this. I don't know how you, in a state that I know Republicans are the minority, but I don't know how you win a race if you fracture your base. And this will fracture your base. Now, he went along and did what he thought he'd do. But let me tell you, if you'll recall, I waited until Monday. And it was like, first of all, it happens on a Friday. That there's nothing that says you got to be in by Saturday at noon. So it was like, I want to think about this because I ain't pulling out. And so it's like, what do you do? So, okay, we're going to write an open letter to Nevada. And if I know that Ken didn't read it. Because Ken doesn't read anything that I did. But anyhow, it was one of those things where you say, listen, yeah, what was profiled there is awful. But I want change. And the other thing is, quite frankly, even though we're Republicans and we love intramurals, it's like, I don't want to be back here. serving with a continuation of this presidency. It's a team sport. So it's like, I'd like to tell you, it's because I'm the greatest guy in the history of the world. It's like, this is a team sport. And the team doesn't win if you're saying the quarterback sucks or the kicker sucks or any of that other sort of stuff. Now, I don't think that's rocket science. But nonetheless, it was one of those things where you just go, listen, man, I'm riding for the brand. And by rights, a member of Congress in a four-district state never should have been a state chairman. I mean, that's for governors and statewide people and stuff like that. But with the exception of Adam Laxalt, there was nobody else that, you know, listen, when it's all milk and honey, it's always easy to be on the, you know, like Friday, it's going to be the inauguration. Yeehaw. Isn't this wonderful? Except for the protesters who think that the Russians still manage the whole thing. But anyhow, it's in times like that where you see who you really want in your foxhole, I think, where it's like, hey, this wasn't your finest hour. But nonetheless, and you think about that, standing with guys like Rudy Giuliani, Mike Pence, Ben Carson, it's like, hell, I'll stand with those folks any day of the week. So anyhow, so now let's make sure that he does the best he can. You know, I don't know what to tell you about Dean. I can tell you this, since the Republican delegation in the United States Congress is now two people big, Dean and I are talking a hell of a lot more than we ever did, you know, a few months ago. So I think Dean will get to where he needs to get, just because it's like, hey, when all else fails, take a look at where you came from. That'll help you. So, hey, thank you guys. You've been very generous with your time.
One last thing, Mark. Shoot. You know, we heard a little bit of talk about it, but not enough about these unelected agencies making laws. This has got to stop.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, actually, the last thing that we did before we left was vote on a House measure that says you have to have the House approve. You have to have the Congress approve regulations. They put a threshold, but it's a fairly low threshold for value before they go into effect, which is nothing more than the Legislative Council Bureau does, the interim Legislative Commission does during the interims. When IRS folks pass a law and the agency goes and does regulations, they got to come back before the legislative branch to see that they did what they were supposed to as far as what the law was. That is not going on federally right now, and that's a huge loophole where they can do pretty much what they want. So thank you, guys.
I wanted to say, I'm sure that Ira and the congressman would stay and answer some questions privately, but don't forget, our next meeting is the 21st. John Sanchez will speak about the economic outlook for 2017. The Lincoln Day is coming up. We'll bug you if you don't come in and join us. But you can stay, talk. We appreciate all of you coming. We really appreciate it.